paisanos! It's the Super Mario Brothers Super Show!
With the Mario Brothers and plumbing's our game. We're not like the others who get all the fame. If your sink is in trouble, you can call us on the double. We're faster than the others, you'll be hooked on the brothers.
So let's say a Scandinavian band is a Nazi band, and then they break up. How many years after can you hate that band for their Nazism, even if they're not a band anymore? From a legal perspective, given that you're a lawyer.
From a legal perspective, I don't think it matters. From a moral perspective, only if they've repudiated their past behavior with both words and acts.
Okay, what kind of actions do you think they'd have to take?
It's a good question. It may depend on how much of a Nazi they were.
How much, like if they were 8% Nazi, yeah, or 92% Nazi?
Yeah, maybe. I mean, I generally am all about calling out Nazis. However, if someone has reformed, because some people grow up in a place and that's what they're taught, you know what I mean? And then, yeah, and when they're young, and then it takes them a while to get a mind of their own.
Right.
Like, I wouldn't want to be judged by some of the stupid stuff I said. And it wasn't like Nazis. It was just like,
sure,
you know, I was a young, straight, white dude in my early 20s. I mean, sure, I still am, but back then I was too. And I had some, I mean, I wouldn't, nothing racist or overtly racist, overtly sexist, but things that I wouldn't understand to the degree that I understand now.
Okay. Well, and the statute of limitations, I'd suggest, on those things is probably much shorter.
Yeah, yeah. For example, when I was in college, Angela Davis was teaching just down the road at UC Santa Cruz.
Oh.
And she had a class where the white people in the class had to sit in the back and just listen.
Okay.
And for me, I was like, I don't understand. Why shouldn't I be able to participate in the class as a 21, 22-year-old? I
got
was
it.
Just like, I wasn't outraged, but I was like, I just don't get it. Now I get it. Sometimes white people need to just listen.
Right. Okay. And that was her point. It was just to have,
yeah,
people,
but
listen.
As a 22-year-old, I didn't understand that because I had come from a place of privilege and didn't understand it to the degree I should have at that time. And now I do.
Right.
So I've done and said things in my past that I'm embarrassed about, and I hope that I do not repeat those.
Of course.
But, you know, so I wouldn't, but you know, there's people that, like, for example, people that get raised as, you know, fans of the Patriots or something.
You mean like the New England Patriots?
Yeah.
Much like my entire family other than me.
Yeah.
Like
so
an unforgivable social
something
offense.
Unforgivable. Right. Yes. Yeah. So you can overcome that in time. You can make penance. You can go around and help blow up the footballs of other teams to the proper inflatedness.
Right, exactly. So meaning like if somebody like my immediate family, my mother, my father, and my brother,
yeah,
for example, liked a team that was cheating all the time,
yeah,
and was a bad team,
yeah,
how long is the statute of limitations on my family?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I don't know. I'll have to...
No, I mean, my main point is that, you know, there's things that you are surrounded by, and then you can come out of those things and learn and better yourself.
Right,
and
right,
we're constantly doing that in life. And so I think if you were a former Nazi, you have to prove that you've gotten past that. And you also have to be okay with people constantly questioning you.
What kind of actions do you think my mother, my father, and my brother could take? What kind of words and what kind of actions could they take to give up their Patriot, New England Patriot past,
I mean,
and move on to, say, become Seahawks,
yeah,
fans?
I mean, I don't know if it's fair to compare Nazism and,
and my mom
and Patriot fandom.
Okay.
I mean, it's close. Don't
right.
get me wrong. It's close.
Uh-huh.
It's I mean, there's 9/11 truthers, and then Patriot fandom is slightly worse. And then Nazis is above that.
If only we had a high listenership in Connecticut, my phone would be blowing up more than it is already right now.
No. Yeah, I think it's a case-by-case thing, and you can't expect everyone to accept someone based on their past actions. And I would hope that most people would become reformed.
Fair enough.
Why is that calendar on June over there, by the way?
Is it not June? No, it's May. I'm gonna switch it.
Okay. Although maybe someone just really loved the Stone Temple Pilots, which is on that calendar.
Well, that's something that probably has a statute of limitations too.
Yeah.
So this is a calendar from the record label Rhino. So we're gonna switch it back to May.
Label.
And May is Cornell. I don't know who Cornell is.
Chris Cornell?
I don't know if it's Chris Cornell. It might just be Cornell. I don't know.
Maybe they're celebrating the university. But yeah, so Punk Rock Pariah, Monday night, 6 to 8 p.m. We are here most Monday nights. We weren't around last week, but you were gone. Where were you?
I was gone. I was finishing up a trip in Chicago, Illinois. I'd flown out to speak at the Rumble, which is a two-day hardcore festival in Chicago, Illinois, put on by my friend Shane Merrill. And he did an incredible job booking it this year. Tons of hardcore bands, mostly from the Midwest, but some from the West Coast, some from the East Coast. And he sold the thing out at 300 or 400 people, and I did about a 25-ish minute set of spoken word on stage, and it went great. It was a really good
time.
What
did you talk about?
This particular set, I opened with a story about 7 Seconds, because the band, they just announced that after 39 years, they're breaking up. So I told a story about meeting 7 Seconds, their singer, for the first time, and how he recognized me.
Whoa.
And how I was shocked about that, because I consider the guy a god. Okay, so hold that thought. Then I told a story about how a guy sent in a strange video to my band's Facebook page, to the Trial Facebook page, and it was him making a selfie video rocking out to one of our songs. And I was going to make fun of him to the other band members, and instead wrote to him directly. And he and I ended up becoming really good friends, and he was a part-time cast member on The Walking Dead.
Oh.
And I'm a huge Walking Dead zombie fan. So then what I did in the spoken word piece after telling those two stories was demonstrate, in the first case with Kevin Seconds, I was idolizing him like a god. In the second case, I was willing to judge this guy before I even knew anything about him. And I asked the audience and asked myself, you know, we come to punk rock and we think of it as an end point. An end point for all the problems we faced outside of punk rock. Mm-hmm. But what happens when we bring in hero worship? What happens when we bring in judgment to punk rock and don't leave that stuff at the door?
Yeah.
Then we haven't created a real alternative. We've just created something to supplement the quote unquote mainstream. So I asked us, what other aspects of ourselves have we brought in here that make this not as good as it could be? So it's cool. I made it funny in the midst of that, and it was pretty fun. I recorded it, and my friend Dan Ellswick flew in from LA to film it. So we're doing a mini documentary on my spoken word in the next couple months. So yeah, it was
and then
cool.
You also went to LA and spoke.
Yeah, I went to LA and did a commercial speaking engagement, where instead of just wearing jeans and a t-shirt, I was wearing a suit and tie.
I have opinions on that.
Yeah, and I can't wait to hear them. I would say that's for a more, you know, I have a whole commercial side of my speaking that I, you know, do for a living. And that was a presentation about making the impossible possible and the aspects of my client's work that would have affected the 3,000 doctors in the audience and put it in terms they understood, because my client's product line is something that I know pretty well. And I was able to communicate ideas by way of that product line to these people in the audience.
Now,
opinions. Let's hear some opinions.
I saw pictures. It was very impressive.
Yep.
But you in a suit.
Yep.
So I think regularly I would trust you with my life.
Okay.
Like if I were having a heart attack, I would go, do it. Bust me open. You're doing open heart surgery right here and now. You'd be like, I don't know anything about it. I'm like, I trust that you'll get it right. Let your intuition guide you. However, when you have a suit on, if I were having a heart attack, I'd be like, how about I trust you to drive me to the hospital and save my life?
Now, what's the difference between the two?
I don't know the Greg in the suit. He's not my Greg.
Got it. I understand.
However, I think, and maybe that audience isn't the right place, it would be kind of fun, though, if there was a way you could work that into your gigs.
Like the spoken word. Wait, maybe the spoken word? Or the commercial.
Yeah,
thing.
Because you could talk about
identity.
Identity and how people judge you and based on what you wear. And it would be amazing if your suit was like a breakaway suit and you could just tear it off and then be wearing your normal clothes underneath.
Can I, with all of our listeners as witnesses, in this moment to what you say next, use that idea?
Yes. I've been thinking about it all week long, about how amazing it would be if you could bring an identity into it and how people judge you based on how you look.
Because that blows my mind. That's the best idea I've heard all day, all week, and I would love to use that idea and have that happen. I think it would be amazing.
I've been reading a book on how TED, like all the things that are best about it, TED Talks, and like how to make a good TED Talk, which you've given before.
Right.
But I'm kind of trying to find a way. I mean, I'd love to give a TED Talk someday, but just work that stuff into my teaching. So even though I have to be there for sometimes an hour and a half, sometimes 3 hours, 2.5 hours, depending on the class, so I can't break things down to a 16 to 18 minute speech, I would like it if there was a way to break down each topic into that so that I can captivate my students in a way that I wouldn't say I'm not able to do, because I've gotten amazing reviews from both my undergrad and grad students, surprisingly.
Right.
But just a way to get them more engrossed in the material. So it's not just words on
piece of paper. Exactly. Okay. Okay. So when you, when you're teaching, what are you wearing normally?
I wear jeans and then a collared shirt and a sweater vest.
Okay. And are you a different person when you're in that outfit versus when you're in your NASA t-shirt in front of me?
I think I'm the same person. I think so, but I don't think I get like the one day that it was so hot in my undergrad class that I had to take off my sweater because it was like 90 degrees in the room and I was just wearing a Star Wars t-shirt. I think for some of those students, they were like, that's awesome. And for other students, it kind of created more like, it gets rid of that wall between you and the student, which is good in some ways, but bad in others.
Yeah, I get that. And I find when I'm on stage wearing the suit, you know, I'm me. I'm just a heightened version of me.
Yeah, there's something to be said about a suit that brings confidence with it, though, because suddenly you have to stand up straight. You have to have good posture or your suit's going to come untucked. You know, you've got the tight noose around your neck. That is the tie. And yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so I think there's something. Yeah, so I feel like you could play around with that idea. And
I love that idea.
And even maybe do it the other way where you come out on stage at a punk show in a suit and see if that changes the reaction that people
Now that's interesting because when I started doing spoken word at punk shows, the reason I did it was because for decades, I'd either been on stage speaking with a band behind me or mm-hmm. singing with a band behind me, or I'd be doing corporate or association events with the full knowledge that the audience was there to hear me. Meaning when I'm on stage in front of 3,000 people in LA, they are there to listen. And I thought, what if I did events in the punk rock community where people weren't anticipating or even necessarily liking the idea of me speaking and I didn't have a band. So then if I added the extra benefit or the extra challenge, which hopefully would be a benefit of me in a suit. So appearing in a way they weren't familiar with, I'm trying to stack all the cards against me and still win. I like that idea.
I think you would win though. You have a way, although I was talking to someone the other day who was like, I love when I see Greg talk because he always, like, you'll be like, where is he going with this? I don't get it. And then he brings it all together.
Yeah, man.
And I was kind of like, I sometimes think maybe Greg doesn't know where he's going in, during the speech, but he knows how to bring it back in. And that's
always
the skill.
Yeah, always. And most times I do know where I'm going, but there are most definitely from time to time, there are times where all of a sudden I'm in left field and all of a sudden just in my brain, I go,
That happens to me on stage, on the stage that is the classroom. All the time, or sometimes I have to keep talking so I can remember just what I was thinking
Absolutely. And you just keep the words flowing and make sure that you're not saying anything totally outlandish and then you bring it back to center.
Yeah. So you're listening to Punk Rock Pariah with Grendel and Greg, Monday nights, 6 to 8 p.m. right here on KXSU LP Seattle 102.1 FM and around the world at KXSU.org. So we have a new segment for the show.
Yeah, we do.
Something we've never done before.
Ooh.
And so I'm kind of excited about it. I made a little theme song for it.
I'm excited.
So here is that theme song. You ready?
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's all go to the
movies.
Let's all go to the
movies.
Let's all go to the
movies. Watch ourselves some crap.
I hate when people talk during the movie.
That's a piece of editing genius. I love more than anything the idea of you eating Uber Eats in your apartment, recording that, eating some snacks.
It was from Grubhub.
Okay, some Grubhub in your place, eating snacks, and that's great. Can we listen to that? Should we listen to that again?
You want to listen to
yeah,
one
I think
more
we
time?
Should listen to it again.
All right, here we go. Channel.
Let's all go to the
movies.
Let's all go to the
movies.
Let's all go to the
movies. Watch ourselves some crap.
I hate when people talk during the movie.
And that is, of course, Arnold Schwarzenegger. And is a Batman and Robin that he's in, where he's Iceman.
Yeah, was it a Batman and Robin? Was it not the Running Man, no.
No. That's from Batman.
Movie, Batman. Okay, yeah, Iceman. Yeah, there you go.
So yeah, we decided that I floated this idea and Greg liked it, and it's interesting because there's so many bad movies out there that neither of us have seen.
Right.
Just because they're bad, and some bad ones that we have seen that I think would be cool to revisit, and so we want to take time to we're going to watch those movies and then we're going to talk about them, so you can either choose to go see them or not go see them.
Good. Okay.
Yeah. So our first movie we did was 1993's film Super Mario Brothers.
Now, when you told me to watch Super Mario Brothers in preparation of the show tonight, my first reaction was, yeah! And then I thought, am I really going to watch Super Mario Brothers and spend my time doing that? And then I thought, 98% of the movies you have ever suggested to me have been winners, total winners. There's only one that I can think of that was a clunker, in my opinion.
We didn't finish Basketball. I think if we finished it, you would come around.
Okay, we'll finish it. Maybe we'll finish it even later tonight. But you've always suggested winners, and I did indeed, today on the plane back from Los Angeles, watch Super Mario Brothers. So yeah, I'd be really curious to hear what you have to say about
it. Well, for those who haven't seen it, 1993 film starring Bob Hoskins and John Leguizamo.
And one of his, got to be one of his first films, it's
right? He had some before that, but it was his first major role.
Yeah,
so it was before Carlito's Way. Okay. It was the one that he was doing, he did just before that. So it was kind of his breakout. But I have the one of the trailers for it, so I thought I'd play that right now.
Please do.
Where are we? I got a feeling we're not in Brooklyn no more.
They're brothers. They're plumbers.
Oh no. Mario! Luigi!
They're on the trail of a kidnapped princess and a mystical meteorite.
It's incredible!
That gives anyone who possesses it the power to rule the universe.
Get me the rock!
Come and get it, lizard breath!
They must rescue the princess.
Luigi! Alien species escaping.
And make it safely back.
Later, alligator.
To our world.
Are you alright?
Before time runs out.
Shoot him!
Look out, Mario!
Get him!
Yes!
Mario Brothers. This ain't no game.
This ain't no game.
That trailer, the audio of that trailer, encapsulates perfectly the chaos that was Super Mario Brothers.
The complete chaos and mess that is the film.
Okay, go ahead.
I would say, this movie came out in 1993, the same time, same summer as Jurassic Park.
Okay.
And it only cost $15 million less than Jurassic Park.
Okay, and that leads to what I was about to say, basically, which is I started watching this thinking, this is a movie that Cameron likes because it's going to be so dumb.
I had never seen it before.
But before this week?
No, this is the first, last night was the first time I had ever seen
this film. Oh, I'm so happy then. I thought I was like entering into your domain.
No, I had never seen this movie.
We're talking about a movie that we've both never seen before.
Never. It came out when I was 14. I wasn't into it at the time, I guess. By then, I was into I was into Jurassic Park. So it was before Pulp Fiction and stuff like that hit that completely changed what I watched. I was probably watching like Reservoir Dogs and stuff
Of course, of course.
So, I had never seen this before. It was one that just I had missed and people hate it. And I was like, we need to go back and watch
this. Okay. And I think people are crazy if they hate this movie because I watched it. I went in thinking this is going to be totally dumb. Mm-hmm. It's a video game movie based mm-hmm. on Mario Brothers. And the whole premise that Mario is this plumber in Brooklyn and his brother and they're plumbers and they're having a hard time. I'm like, this is going to be so dumb. And I enjoyed the entire movie.
Yeah.
I thought it was ridiculous.
Yep.
The premise is stupid. A lot of dumb things happen. But there were times that I laughed out loud. There were times that I was totally enjoying myself, which is most of the film. There was even a moment where I was shocked. And I mean, spoilers, everybody. Super Mario Brothers might be ruined for you in a few moments. The scene with the Twin Towers.
Yeah. That was like, dude. Whoa.
Okay, so there's a scene where the world that we're in.
So wait, let's go back. I'm going to read the opening monologue.
Please do.
So the film starts with this monologue. It's like this weird, not even 8-bit, screen of like plants and stuff. And it goes, a long time ago, the earth was ruled by dinosaurs. They were big, so not a lot of people went around harassing them. actually, no people went around her hassling them because there weren't any people yet. Just the first tiny mammals. Basically, life was good. Then something happened. A giant meteorite struck the Earth. Goodbye, dinosaurs. So you're like, okay, yeah. I'm with it.
Okay.
It goes on, but what if the dinosaurs weren't all destroyed? What if the impact of that meteor created a parallel dimension where the dinosaurs continued to thrive and evolve into intelligent, vicious, and aggressive beings? Just like us? And hey, what if they found a way back?
Okay, so at that point, I thought to myself,
you trying to plug that in?
Yeah, I'll bring it over there. Okay. Yeah, I just want it to die because people are writing in. So at that point, I thought to myself, this is going to be so bad.
Right?
But there was something about the presentation of it.
So did you recognize the voice of the narrator?
I didn't.
It was Dan Castellaneta, Homer Simpson from The Simpsons.
Very interesting, which continues our thread of talking about The Simpsons and mm-hmm. different issues related to that show.
Oh, and there's more. You were gone. We didn't even get to talk about the more stuff that happened related to that show. We'll go back.
We'll go back. But at that point, I realized this movie might be very dumb, but that monologue was self-aware enough mm-hmm. that I was like, this movie knows that it's dumb, which is going to draw me in, and it might actually be really entertaining. I'm telling you, there were some times throughout that I was loving it. The moment with the Twin Towers was a moment where two worlds, to put it very simply, two worlds are merging.
Yeah, like the two dimensions are coming together.
Yeah. And in order to show that was happening, like two people face-to-face talking would pixelate and kind of like blend into one another. But then they show the two twin towers from the top down starting to pixelate. And it looked like they were collapsing.
Yeah, yeah.
It looked a lot like, you know, 9/11. I was like, oh my God, someone really regretted that special effects choice. So, but yeah, there was, yeah, it was a lot of...
I caught that too. I was like, whoa!
I know, me too.
I think the thing about this movie, and so the premise is this. A woman is running away and she goes into, I guess she goes into the other universe somehow and puts an egg on a church step like one would an orphan, bangs on the door and runs away and then gets caught by Koopa, King Koopa,
right.
Who's played by the amazing Dennis Hopper.
Incredible.
Like, and he's no exception in this film. Like, it's exactly what you would expect. But in fact, he has some real creepy moments with Daisy.
Yeah.
And just like, he's a real creep. Because he's the bad guy.
He was good though in this film. I liked him a lot.
He was great. So and then the egg hatches and becomes Daisy and she grows up in the modern world, not knowing that she's from a princess from this other world.
Right.
And then, she wears the piece of a meteorite around her neck. So the whole premise is if you can take that piece of meteorite and put it into the meteorite that hit Earth, it will merge the two dimensions back together.
Right. Exactly.
So that's the whole premise of the film. Now, I enjoyed it. It's not great, but it was fun.
It was absolutely fun. And if somebody had nothing to do and wanted to shut their brain off for 90 minutes, oddly enough, I can't believe I'm saying this, I recommend Super Mario Brothers.
Here's the thing about it. Like, the making of the movie was such a disaster. Like, Bob Hoskins, who, you know, is an amazing actor who played Mario, and by the way, they decided they had to have last names in this movie, so their last name is Mario. So it's Mario, Mario, and Luigi Mario, because they're the Mario brothers.
Yep.
Which is almost more fair, because I always thought it was unfair that they're the Mario brothers, and then Luigi is just like his brother.
Right.
Like, why aren't they by their last name?
Yeah,
so
exactly.
They made their last name Mario. I guess it had been written, the script was written, they threw it out, they brought in new script writers, rewrote it. That second script is how all the actors got attached to it.
Okay.
Originally, it was like a fantasy movie. Uh-huh. And then it became the dark movie that it was. But then those two got fired. And then even while they were filming scenes, they had these two new writers who were rewriting scenes.
So it was like almost like in process. We were watching it happen as it unfolded.
Yeah. And okay. So some people kind of think, this is a theory I saw on the internet, and I think this might be true, that they basically took another movie that they had in mind and then just put the Mario universe on top of it. Because if you erase Mario from this film, any references to the video games, suddenly it's a very different movie and you take it in a different way that you would a Mario movie.
Absolutely. And I found myself looking for Mario references, like the fireballs being shot at him mm-hmm. and going up and down elevators and that kind of thing.
The only thing they got right was the Bob-omb.
What's the Bob-omb?
The little bomb at the end that he twists up. That's actually from the games.
Okay.
But like the games, it's like a sunny world where it's bright out and there's like...
Yeah.
A, guys in the clouds throwing spinies at you, and none of this, like Dino Hatton, which was instead of Manhattan, right, where they went to when they went to the other dimension, was like dark and dangerous, and Big Bertha, and who's CD. A fish in the video game, yeah, is suddenly like a large woman who throws a grandma over a bridge and to die, but she lands in a car and car accident. Like, it is bizarre.
It's bizarre. And anybody listening to us talk about this must think that this movie is insane.
It is insane.
Let's
do a spoiler alert. I love the fact that the bad guy in the real world gets turned into a monkey at the end.
Yeah,
it was
great.
So satisfying.
Very satisfying.
And you could tell by the way it ended, they were setting up a franchise.
Good point.
Now, did you stay for the stinger at the end? Did you watch it all the way through?
No, I didn't. I should.
So at the very end, they come in and there's two Japanese gentlemen who are asking the two cousins if they want to make a movie, and they're trying to think of a name of it. And it's like the Super Koopa Cousins or something. So clearly they were setting up to be a franchise. It didn't happen.
Yeah.
One of the major problems, Bob Hoskins didn't even know it was a video game movie until he mentioned to his kid what he was doing. And his kid goes, "That's a video game movie." He had no idea about the source material.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy.
And so many people got hurt during the filming of it. He broke his hand or his fingers during one of the scenes, so I didn't notice it. But I guess as you're watching the film, he's wearing like a prosthetic, it's a cast that they color flesh colored so that it looks like it's his hand, because his hand got broken during like one of the driving scenes where Luigi crashes the car or something.
I mean, I watched it and I was, I don't want to say I was amazed, but I was very surprised. I thought for sure this was going to be just a total train wreck.
Yeah, and I mean, it was a train wreck, but almost in a good way.
In a good way.
Yeah, and the first thing that struck out to me, once the movie started, was the music, the score. Like when the Koopa cousins are like chasing after Daisy before you know who they are, it's got like a really classical, like 50s, 60s score to it.
And the film has that look throughout it. The film looks like a 50s or 60s movie at times. The way that Daisy's makeup and whatnot is done when she's in the alternate reality looks very 50s.
It also, like, especially early on, has a lot of slapstick. Like, those two cousins are super slapstick.
100%. And not only that, but when Mario, I can't believe we're having this serious discussion about Super Mario Brothers the movie. When Mario is trying to get the piece of the meteorite off the neck of the woman on the dance floor, and he's trying so hard to do it without by distracting her or have her not notice he's taking off the necklace. That's a very funny and very slapstick scene. Yeah. And I actually found myself laughing.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, I'm watching on a plane and I was kind of embarrassed almost that I was laughing. Not as much as I was embarrassed when I was laughing during the sex scene of Team America World Police on an airplane when I came so unglued that I couldn't even hold my head up and I was crying and drooling. I was laughing so hard. Sitting in first class next to business people who were looking over at the laptop watching puppets fornicate. But it was pretty fun today on the airplane watching that movie.
Yeah, I surprisingly enjoyed it. I was expecting it to be way worse than it was, and going in with no expectations, and I liked it. And I think one of the problems was everyone wanted a real Mario movie, and that's not what they got.
Yeah.
And so you can't even see the movie because you're so upset that they ruined the source material, which they absolutely did.
Yeah, of course.
There's, except for the Bob-omb, and Yoshi is like the family pet in the Koopa. Like, he's pretty good. It does not really, like, they don't even really involve sliding, like going up and down plumber pipes, except for plumber pipes, just pipes.
Yeah, pipes.
Except for like the one scene where they're riding a mattress down it as they.
It's so dumb.
Yeah.
So dumb.
But in the whole time, there's this fungus that's everywhere that turns out to be Daisy's king father. And they get this amazing actor to play him. And he has like two lines, or no, one line.
Right.
He coughs when he comes back and he goes, I love those plumbers or something like that. It's so, like, you have, like, one of the best known actors at that time, like, well, not, like, famous, but, like, established as, like, a great actor.
Right.
And then he has one line.
Amazing. So along the lines of video game movies, I don't know if is that all you had to say?
Yeah, about just, Super Mario Brothers? I give it thumbs up.
I give Super Mario Brothers a thumbs up, and it's not going to make you a smarter person. It's not going to change the world. But if you ever have the feeling that you want to watch a dumb movie, but you don't really want to watch a dumb movie, watch Super Mario Brothers.
That's a good one.
Okay, so what about this movie that's out now that everyone's going crazy over that I saw last night in Los Angeles called Ready Player One?
I like how you described it as everyone's going nuts about it. Like a month ago, everyone was
I mean, in LA.
We're into the new Marvel movie and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and I mean, my friends in LA had seen it 4 times and were still going nuts over it.
Really?
Yeah, and I saw it last night in LA, and I was kind of overwhelmed by it, meaning a lot happens. Like there's some scenes visually in that film where you just can't take your eyes off, you know, chase scenes where you can't take your eyes off the screen and you're kind of overwhelmed. But you said you had opinions on this movie and you've not even seen it. So that's what I want to hear about.
So the movie is built on nostalgia, basically.
100%.
And I usually love stuff like that. I think one of the problems with that, and this is a critique I've seen of it. I'm sure it's a great movie and I'll see it one day. Spielberg, right?
It is.
And most Spielberg movies, I was looking through his stuff. There's some of the later stuff I don't particularly love, the one worry I have about it is, a lot of the people are like when they choose their, what's the word for the avatar? Whoever they're being inside the secret world.
Avatar. I think they use avatar. Yeah.
Okay. Some of them are choosing white people when they're not white. And then it's like they have to look at the white guy to save the day. And so it's almost like this whitewashing of how, like, the day would be saved into being like only a white guy can do it.
Yeah, okay.
And what I worry about there is you have these Gamergate bros, and I call them bros because they just are not open-minded and they're not like jock bros, but you know, who see that that's right. Yes, we have a white savior, and I think we have enough white saviors in movies.
100%, that is true. Yes.
Yeah. So, and I'm sure it's a great, and I can divorce myself from that kind of stuff while watching something sometimes. And I'm sure I would love it because I love nostalgia. I'm all about eating those member berries, as South Park called them, where it's like when things aren't good, they're just people like it because they're nostalgic.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that you'd like this movie, but it was, I mean, while I enjoyed it, it was no Super Mario Brothers.
I mean, that's true regardless. Doesn't mean it's better or worse. That just means it's not.
It's not. It literally was not the same movie.
I definitely plan on seeing it. It's a little bit further down my list, though, because I haven't seen the new Marvel movie yet.
And I haven't either.
Have you seen Quiet Place?
I have not, and I really want to. A friend of mine who doesn't hear wrote me saying that she was watching that, meaning a friend of mine who's deaf wrote me saying that she was watching that. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. I want to hear her response after I see the film. So I got to write her back. And
yeah, no, it's good.
Yeah.
I loved it.
Okay, say no more because I haven't seen that. I'm excited more than anything for Deadpool 2. Cannot wait for Deadpool 2.
That's coming soon, right?
May 18th, I think.
Okay.
Super excited. Yeah, very soon.
So you're listening to Punk Rock Pariah with Grendel and Greg, Monday nights from 6 to 8 p.m. right here on KXSU LP Seattle, 102.1 FM, and around the world at KXSU.org. Also, you could be listening on the podcast we have, which you can get at punkrockpariah.com or iTunes, Stitcher.
iHeartRadio,
TuneIn, Google Play Music. Spotify.
KXSU.org.
Or you could just play a random station ID and scare the crap out of me.
That's loud. Cool. That was loud. We have a PSA to read here real fast. Let me pull it up. Hello, KXSU. Give back during any time between 11 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. on May 9th with the Parent and Family Engagement Group. The event is the Kids Clothing Swap that will be held in the Student Center here on campus, room 130. Bring your gently used, clean kids' clothes to share and find new ones for your own kids. Interesting.
Okay, cool. All right.
Yeah.
What else we got topic-wise? As always, our topics are listener-generated, yep. And then each week we also have some segments that we do. If you have a topic and you want it covered on the show, whether that's just a topic or a topic for our segment called Greg Dates, where we give often ridiculous but always astute dating advice, even though we can't keep our own dating lives together, you can tweet us at Greg Benick, GREGBENNICK, or at Legal Minded Punk. And you could also write us on Facebook. You could email us, tweet, text, whatever you want. Come in the studio, tell us to our faces.
Yeah.
And then each week we also play a song of the week as well.
That's what I have queued up right now, is my song of the week.
Sweet. What is it?
Which is a band that I mentioned before and you said you hadn't heard of, so I hope I haven't played this before you before and we just didn't talk about what it is. But it's a band called Vanilla Muffins.
I've not heard of Vanilla Muffins.
And their song, No Punk Rock in My Car.
Okay.
So here it is. Vanilla Muffins, Punk Rock, or yeah, Punk Rock Pariah is the name of our show. No Punk Rock in My Car.
I loved that song. You and I absolutely agree on that band. Yes. Tell me more about them.
They are a sugar-oi band, a genre they invented from Basel, Switzerland.
What does sugar-oi mean?
It's like oi music that's like poppy, pop punk, like sing about fun stuff.
Amazing. I loved it. You know what it reminded me of? It reminded me a lot of the Misfits.
Oh, I could see that.
Absolutely.
That album was called The Drug is Football, meaning soccer. Unsurprisingly to you, I bet, once you'll hear this fact, Chris Cab loves this band.
Wait, not surprising.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's definitely right up his alley. And I think he's been like, so they released like the 12-inch vinyl of that, and it's super rare, and then... So all of us have been searching for it a long time. I feel like he might have even been abroad looking for it before.
That totally strikes me as something our friend Chris Cab would do. I could see him flying over to England in order to find this record specifically and watch soccer games.
Yeah, so they are, you know, from Switzerland and are mainly in Europe. They've toured the U.S. the first time in the year 2000, and I think they've probably been a few times since, but it's not much. Like it says here in this old bio, a 2001 tour was planned for the East Coast, but
and didn't happen.
Who knows?
I like that band enough that I want to listen to them as soon as we're off the air again.
Yeah.
That was great.
Yeah. So you have a song of the week too.
I do have a song of the week. I wanted to listen to Rocky Votolato. Rocky is
that how you pronounce it?
Yeah, Rocky Votolato.
Oh, I always thought it was Votolato.
Votolato. You know, let's text him and ask
text
him.
Rocky.
I'm going to text Rocky and ask him.
I mean, I could be wrong. I've probably heard him on the end on the local show years ago. But
yep. Well, we'll text him and get to the bottom
of
it.
So was Rocky in Waxwing?
Rocky was in Waxwing.
Okay.
And he has just a long legacy of being involved in music.
Yeah.
And his whole family's involved in music. Every one of the brothers and sisters in the Votolato family. But, you know, Rocky's done a ton of solo material after Waxwing. Mm. And I'm excited about Rocky for multiple reasons. One, he's amazing as a human being. He's an environmental activist. He's an incredibly talented singer-songwriter.
We should have him on the show.
Oh my gosh. I'm going to text him. That'll be the second half of the text. Absolutely. I would love to have Rocky on the show. He's a sweetheart. But what I also am excited about is that I'm eventually doing a spoken word record where different musicians are contributing original musical tracks. And then I'm going to be speaking over those tracks. And Rocky gave me a track just last month, and it's genius. He wrote it in 20 minutes.
Wow.
And it's the second he started playing it, it almost brought me to tears, both of excitement and emotion, because it was just so good. But yeah, I'm just overjoyed about it. Super excited to have him involved. So this is
the second track.
Yeah,
right?
Called The Hereafter. And the record is called Hospital Handshakes.
Came out in 2015 on No Sleep Records.
Yeah, just amazing stuff. Rocky's brilliant. He's currently on tour doing a living room tour. What, you know, Rocky can sell big venues, but what he tends to do is play intimate small venues. He'll announce that he's going to do a living room tour, and he says, here are the cities I want to hit, and he'll name 30 cities around the country. Mm-hmm. And if you want to book him in your living room, you just write him.
Yeah.
And say, you talk about the conditions of what he needs. And I saw him at a living room show here in Seattle about a year ago. And it was mind-boggling. It was like 30 of us there. He recorded it. It came out on an LP. And he's on a living room tour right now. So if people are interested in the future and booking Rocky, stay in touch with his social media and you can have him play in your living room.
And this right here, it looks like it has some real good artists performing with him as well. Cody's on a few tracks.
Absolutely.
His brother Cody.
Yeah.
Chris Walla, who is
Death
Chris
Cab.
From Death Cab.
Yeah, for
is
sure.
On a bunch of the tracks, if not all of them. So that's... Oh, and Alex... Who I know from Cumulus, she's on here as well.
Oh, cool.
So here is track two of The Hereafter off of Rocky Votolato's album, Hospital Handshakes.
I learned to starve and beat this animal until I found out I lived in a temple. Got such a bleeding.
That was Rocky Votolato with The Hereafter off of Hospital Handshakes. And I've been texting Rocky during the song playing.
Votolato.
Votolato, not Votolato. And hold on, all a new text is coming in.
All the people I know who told me that were wrong. So I'm glad we can get it right, because there's, as we've talked about before, there's one thing I hate is getting people's names
yep.
wrong.
Yep. Well, and Rocky says, potentially coming in as a guest. He's out on tour, and oftentimes he kind of goes into reclusive hiding mode after mm-hmm. tours, but we'll see if we can get him in here. But that song was really, really, really important to me, especially last year. I remember, you know, last year I went through a particularly complicated breakup. Mm-hmm. And in the months following, I just dove into that. You know, what does that feel like to go through a bad breakup? And, you know, what kind of questioning of yourself do you go through? And I remember so many times listening to that song and really connecting with that middle section where it kind of breaks down and he says, I can't handle any more cruelty. My hands are burned and scarred from holding way too much already. I've been way too hard on me. Please be gentle. Be gentle, please. Those lyrics still give me shivers, even now.
So good.
So good, because it's like, you know, after a breakup or after a particularly intense emotional experience, you're often way, way, way too hard on yourself and critical of yourself. And I could have done something differently. I didn't do enough. The kind of residual conversations and the negativity maybe of the relationship linger. You question yourself. And just that idea of like, you know, my hands are burned and scarred from holding way too much cruelty already. And I've been too hard on myself. But then at the end, that plea, please be gentle, please. My God, at the end of the day, that's all of us want. And I'm convinced of that. From traveling, speaking in 25 countries around the world, that people want gentleness. They want to be treated well and with respect. They want to be loved. They want to love other people. And just that idea of please be gentle, please, is just fantastic.
Morphing that conversation, then how do we approach people who aren't gentle then from a gentle perspective?
Okay. So,
I mean, I think that takes almost a Dalai Lama.
Does it ever.
You know, like Martin Luther King type of Gandhi, turn the other cheek, like.
And let's agree that we will fail in that endeavor sometimes, right?
So fail most times.
Absolutely. So yeah. If somebody approaches us with cruelty, somebody approaches us with a lack of communication, a lack of empathy. Yes, it's possible to respond to them compassionately and empathically. Hmm. Yes, it's possible to respond to them with intensity. Either could be right. Both might be wrong. Undoubtedly, we're going to mess it up. Both are possible. It all depends on what is going to make us feel better in the future for ourselves, I mm-hmm. think. You know, and ultimately, in the times of my life where I've been, and I don't mean this romantically, in relationship, right? So, in communicative connection with another person, and something goes wrong, I find that, you know, doing the thing or taking the approach which I can live with best years from now is the way to go. Like in the moment, it might feel great to lash out. And that's not even true for me. I don't feel great lashing out at people. Mm-hmm. But in the moment, if you're angry, you might say something, you know, that's ego inflating for you. But a year from now, you're going to want to text that person and say, hey, I'm really sorry.
But even if it's someone you don't know, especially in today's internet culture, it's hard to approach someone from a place of compassion
yeah.
when what they're bringing to you is negativity.
Oh my God, totally.
And it's especially hard for me because I'm trained to argue. And when someone, I have this assumption, I think we've talked about this before on the show. I have this assumption that people have a base level of like rationality. And I think that assumption is wrong because a lot of the ideas and just the way I think are driven by how privileged I've been in the education that I've
had.
For
sure, for sure.
And that's something that is missing for a lot of other people, unfortunately. And I wish that it would still work for them. You know,
I'm with you, yeah.
No, So if someone can't have a rational argument with me and discuss their point of view in relation to mine, I will often cut them down or cut them off.
No, I get that.
Because I just don't have time to deal with the BS.
So, not to change the subject at all, but Rocky is texting me even as we speak, and Rocky says, after he finishes his new record, so it'll be tour, work on new record, then absolutely he'll come in as
yeah.
a guest, which makes me very happy.
Amazing.
Also, living room shows in Seattle on June 9th, Woodinville, Washington, June 8th, and Rocky says he's on a 5-night sold-out streak and just pulled into Kansas tonight for his show in Kansas tonight. So Rocky Votolato.
That's amazing. And you can go to RockyVotolato.com.
There you go.
Or Rocky Votolato on Twitter.
Yeah, the man. We love Rocky very, very, very,
that's
very much.
Totally awesome. I wish I wish I were here for the wax wing stuff.
You mean like you had been kind of present? Because were you?
I moved away in 98.
Yeah.
And so they, I think 96, 97 that was probably right, around. Yeah. So they, and then they broke up right. while I was gone.
Yep.
So I was never exposed to wax wing until many years later.
The good news is that he has been known to do a wax wing song or two from time to time, especially even on request at some of these living room shows.
Wow.
So if cool. you were to write to him or tweet at him, and let him know that, he'd probably play one.
I feel bad though, unless he wanted to, because I wouldn't want him to not play something he wanted to play just because I wanted him to play a wax wing song. You know, it's like, I remember interviewing Brendan Kelly from Lawrence Arms, and he talked about how when they first became a band, people would just constantly scream Broadway songs at him, and he'd be like, we're a different band.
Or like Ian MacKay, when Fugazi started playing out, I was at the Anthrax, this might have been 1987, 88, and everyone screamed, play Minor Threat songs, and he's just like, get over it. Like it's.
Whereas, yeah, I might do that, but I also now, I feel like with his next band, I would have yelled Fugazi songs.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm wary of that.
That said, Stephen Wilson, who I don't know if you know, Stephen Wilson's from a band called Porcupine Tree. That's his old band, but he does solo songs now. Stephen Wilson is in Seattle tomorrow night at Showbox, and I am desperately in love with this guy's music. And he has a song called Hand Cannot Erase. That's Stephen with Steven Wilson, Hand Cannot Erase. And on his current tour, I've been checking his set list, and he's been playing Hand Cannot Erase from time to time. And I most definitely tweeted at him today and said, at Stephen Wilson HQ, please, please, please play Hand Cannot Erase in Seattle tomorrow night, because it's in this crazy 9-4 time signature. And I said, I want to nerd out with my friends and count, you know, odd time signatures and you know, enjoy this incredible song. So if you're out there, listen to Hand Cannot Erase by Stephen Wilson. That's a gem of a song.
Something I forgot to mention earlier was that there is a Super Mario movie that's being made, a new one.
Like another one?
Yeah.
Like a remake?
It's not even live action. It's from the studio that made Minions.
Oh, really?
So they're going to make a real, and the way they actually said it wasn't a Super Mario. It was a movie starring Mario. So it could be in a different context, I suppose. But there's going to be a Minions style movie with Mario in it.
Okay.
So we will maybe get another one coming out.
Just a continual thread. It's like Greg Dates. It just keeps coming back again and again and again.
We had one come in from our friend Aaron.
A topic?
Yeah.
Okay.
Aaron Morgan.
Oh, Aaron Morgan. The artist Aaron Morgan.
Yes.
Seattle artist.
We had a bunch of really good topics from Aaron, but most of them are too long for what we have left in this hour.
Okay.
So I think we're going to take one of his that, not that it's a bad topic, but it's not in a very in-depth topic.
Okay.
I think it's a little divisive. I think it is something that I say it's a hard topic. I mean, not a hard topic, but in some ways it is. I feel like it could split generations. It can create problems within families.
You're talking about Super Mario Brothers, the movie, right?
Kind of, but no. And it's something that I think could change humanity for the better or worse. And the question is, hot dogs versus hamburgers.
I knew there had to be a hook. I know Aaron Morgan far too well to know that he would come up with something more. Anyway, let's just get right into it. Hot dog versus hamburger.
Yeah, hot dog versus hamburger.
Okay. Having been at Mohawk Bend in L.A. this last week, restaurant in Echo Park, and having eaten the Impossible Burger, which in my opinion is the best vegan burger.
I had one recently at Lil Woody's.
Best vegan burger that's ever come out. Forget about it. Meat is done as a concept as far as I'm concerned. There's no need for a meat hamburger anymore.
So the problem with that is they charge $5 extra to change it to that patty, and everywhere seems universally to do that, and that's ridiculous.
It's ridiculous.
So meat will not be replaced until that comes down.
100%, and I've taken issue with them and tweeted that at the company before.
I mean, it's ridiculous that you can pay $10 for a burger or $15 for the vegan version.
$20 at Mohawk Bend.
Well, it's L.A.
Yeah, so. L.A. But still, delicious. So I'm kind of on a hamburger kick right now because the Impossible Burger. White Castle in the Midwest is selling the Impossible Burger.
Yep,
and it's
they're
$2.
Have vegan. Yeah, so it's. I mean, their burgers are small though.
Yep.
So yeah, I've never had White Castle proper.
Yeah.
Because I was vegan before.
Me too.
Anywhere on the West Coast.
Yeah.
It's in Vegas now.
Oh, I didn't know that.
There. So now, hopefully next time I'm in Vegas, they'll have it there. I have had the frozen White Castle burgers. They used to come little burgers in packs of six cook in the microwave.
Yep.
So I had those. In college, I used to eat those a lot. Because you can just throw them in the microwave in your dorm room. But yeah, you know, I think we could talk a lot about vegan food. And we'll talk more about vegan food next hour.
Yep, for sure.
Next show. But for now, hot dog versus hamburger. That's hard for me because I feel like they're different for different situations. So at a baseball game, I'm going to eat a hot dog.
100%. You're going to eat 1.5 hot dogs, exactly. Which is what we've determined to be the right amount.
So that is a baseball food. However, there are times where I prefer hamburgers.
What's an example? What's an occasion where you'd prefer a hamburger?
You know, if I'm out eating at a restaurant, a hot dog doesn't feel like a restaurant food. I can make that at home.
Like at a fine dining establishment?
Yeah, like Red Robin. Fine dining. You know, and they used to have the Boca Burger, which is vegan, and then they had a Garden Burger, which wasn't.
Right.
And now they have just a Black Bean Burger, which is made by Morningstar Farms, but specifically for them and is vegan.
Cool. Okay.
So you have to be in the mood for a Black Bean Burger. I'm not always in the mood. True. I think it has a certain flavor, and yep. I'm, as much as I didn't like the Boca when it first started, it got to the point where I actually like it because it became normal for me.
Mm-hmm.
So I think when I'm out eating at a restaurant, I generally would order a burger. I've never been huge on burgers, though. I will say that, and anyone out there, you can fight me if you want. Dick's is better than In-N-Out.
You're going to get a lot of feedback about that.
And a lot of people are going to be wrong because Dick's is 100%, I've eaten both, 100% better than In-N-Out.
What I will say about burgers is I like when they're stacked high. And the burger that I got at Mohawk Bend was a double cheeseburger.
How do you fit them in your mouth?
You have to work hard.
Yeah,
it was two Impossible Patties, and that's a pretty good deal because there's places like Umami in LA is charging, I think, $18 for the Impossible Burger, and it's one patty, which is ridiculous. So I would say I like burgers when they're double stacked and they've got tons of fixings on them and all sorts of goodies. So, you know, the single burger doesn't really do much for me. And I'm loving hot dogs too, of course, because you and I have hot dogs, vegan hot dogs down to a science.
And I eat hot dogs at home all the time because it's something I can just throw it on the George Foreman grill, some veggie dog or sausage, depending. And I think there's a difference between hot dogs or sausages too.
Oh, like if you give me a field roast apple sage sausage, I'll take that any day of the week over any hot dog.
Now, I usually grill them, but I remember there were some times where I boiled them because they have the wrapper.
Yep.
And you boil them in a pot of water.
Yep.
And those are really good too.
Yep, for sure. And I haven't boiled those, but I used to boil actual hot dogs as a kid.
Yeah.
But most of my hot dog consumption is with you walking down the street after Mariners games.
Yeah, that's true.
But I have to say that I would bust out my George Foreman grill any day of the week and cook some apple sage sausages. That would be tremendous.
I definitely want them to be some impossible. Sorry. Listeners chiming in. Yeah, that's what's up, Rich. Okay. Inappropriate to say over the air.
I know exactly what Rich said. Now that I could read it even without seeing it. But anyway, let's go on from there.
Let's say goodbye for this hour. Thanks for listening, everybody.
Thanks for listening, everybody.
We'll see you next time. You can get us on punkrockpariah.com or check out the podcast, Punk Rock Pariah with Grindle and Greg, on iTunes, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, Google Play Music. TuneIn, Spotify, did I say Stitcher? Stitcher, everywhere your podcast favorite places are. Me speak English good too. Go there, and if it's not there, tell us, and we'll get it on there. So we'll see you all next time.
Thanks, everybody.
Nintendo. It's for breakfast now.
Nintendo.
It's a cereal.
Wow.
Nintendo.
Super Mario Jump.
Nintendo.
Cereal system is a super part of this nutritious breakfast.
Nintendo.
Two cereals at once.